end of 1995, that person Andy presented the new act, which removed 21.2 and accepted Chinese education as the permanent landscape of the Malaysian education system. And I would say since that new act was formed, the system, the primary school system had become much more, I would say, accommodating and liberal. And since then, significant capital grants have been allocated to the vernacular schools, the mission schools, and also the scholar Agama Rakyat. Since that period, many interesting characters of this school have emerged. And now I would like to talk some parts about something about that. One very common feature, as emphasized just now, is that these schools still continue to enjoy huge community support. If there's a fundraising dinner, thousands would turn up, as this is in Kepong 2, near where I stay. And that night, about 3,000 people attended in a makeshift kind of roof. The interesting part is, there were no VIPs, no ministers, nothing. Just organized by the Board of Governors and the VIPs. They just, everybody came in, they had their dragon dance, they had the shows and so on, and everybody just donated and left. And that this is happening everywhere. Now, every weekend, you go all over the country, in the temples, in the balai rayas, in the school halls, you find fundraising dinners being organized for whatever activity, like some to raise money for musical bands, some to hire temporary teachers, some all kinds of some to improve on the classrooms and so on. And the schools continue to serve as the center for community activities. It is a place that, especially in the smaller towns, it is a place to think of when the children want to get married, or when they have birthday dinner, or whatever. A good example of this is Dr. So Tin Han. I look at that, he's a national footballer. But what I want to show you is, his father celebrated his 100th birthday. For men to live 100 years, not easy. He's still very, very much active in Alugaja. You go there in the evening, you see him running around, he chit-chat with you and so on. He celebrated his 100th birthday in the Alugaja Chinese school. And incidentally, he was one of the founders of the school also. So it's quite, he still look very active. And when I go back, we still say hello and you can still see him singing the karaoke and so on. I mean, out in the small towns, it's easy to understand. And Chin Han is a good son. Everywhere the father goes, he go and wait. My son is sitting here, I'm telling him a subtle message. Okay, one common feature, Chinese schools teachers have tremendous pressure. Each Chinese school have a board of governors and a PTA. Of course, PTA is there. But the board of governors consists of the big shots in the village, big shots in the village, big shots in the town. And when the board, chairman of the board of governors comes to school, the HM stands, Every teacher shivers because he's checking on the progress of the school. So not easy to be a Chinese school headmaster or headmaster or teacher. Because board of governors, some of them, very few of them are politicians, but most of them are, tycoons. The chairman of the Kuala Lumpur Sekolah Jalan Davidson is none other than Tan Sri Yotong Le. So if he comes to school, everybody better stand attention. So it's that kind of pressure. And the teachers are expected to help in fundraising. Very basic things like arranging tables and chairs, And in the classroom, they have to carry the pupils to run on the board, In SAKC Eng Chuan Pinang, and this school incidentally is established by the Hokkien Association. And of course, in many schools, in the outlying areas, the teachers live in the school, especially places such as Pulau Ketam. And because you live in the school, you're expected to work 24 hours for the school, so you have to run nighttime activities for the school students. The villagers expect it. You want to be part of our village, you better take our children as your kids and teach them nicely. So that's the method. And then, to be fair, every time the school has an activity, the whole village turn up and support. respect to learning Mandarin. Mandarin is a pictographic language. Learning it requires, by definition, pattern recognition and block learning and memorization. Many SJKCs today, with the help of the school board and the PTAs, have installed computer teaching technologies, especially facilities like smart boards in the school. A smart board in school is not cheap. You know? One board is about 30,000. So imagine the amount of money that the board has to raise to install. What is a smart board? For Chinese teaching, Mandarin teaching, it is very useful because it enables the teacher to teach the logic behind the development of a character. For example, in this one, they're teaching, obviously, a primary one class. The origin of the word mi, rice, you know, start out from a box, from a tong with rice, and so on, eventually evolved to be a character, rice. So if you use a computer-aided technology, then the children, hopefully, can relate to the pattern much easier. And of course, they also use the board for teaching Bahasa and English. This is in Fong Yu School. And this one is in SJKC Yokping, where they have a very intensive interactive learning. And I must say that Chinese schools, by and large, under the pressure of the parents and the PTAs, many of them actually are prepared to introduce computer-aided learning so that make it more fun for the students. You know why? Another reason is the increasing presence of the international schools. Many of the Chinese parents actually send their children to international schools, you know. If they don't get the type of education that they feel they ought to have from these schools. Another interesting feature is that because of the movement of the population, some schools that were big before become very small schools. A good example is SJKC Bukit Fraser. It's a large school with 6 or 7 classrooms, but today there's only one student and two teachers. The students send a tree so the school can still survive for another few years before they worry about it. On the other side, there are schools that are grossly over-congested. This is an example of school Yat Chi in Pochung. Total enrollment is 4,000. And then it's divided into two sessions of 2,000, morning 2,000, afternoon 2,000. And this picture was taken at about 12:50, when all the 2,000 students assembled in the hall before the start of the afternoon session. And they have only about 15 minutes for the 2,000 students to get out of the classroom in the morning session one, and for them to get in, you know. So every day, every school day, at about 12:50, it's a whole military precision kind of thing. Teachers line up in the classroom, line up in class, teachers, students walk out, students walk in, 2,000, 2,000. Done, 15 minutes, and that's it. It's nice to go there. And there are other schools like in Skudai and so on, similar conditions. Now I talk to the main topic. Adaptation to the multi-ethnic environment. Now, what better way to start with the SJKC in Sarawak? Sarawak is really the melting pot of Malaysia. So everything works in Sarawak. In Sarawak today, there are a number of Chinese school SJKCs who runs on two streams. One stream of classes teaching in Bahasa, one stream of classes teaching in Mandarin. How did it come about? Pre-1960, many churches in Sarawak had classes in English, classes in Mandarin, the same church compound, the same school. So when Raman Yako, 1969, invoked Clause 21.2, converted all the English streams classes into Bahasa, many of the churches retained the English stream as a Bahasa stream, and then they also run the Mandarin stream. And then today, a number of these schools conduct their classes in two language streams, in a single school, under a single administration, same HM, same teachers, same canteen time, and the same set of discipline. Very interesting. In Kuching, SJKC Song Keng High, the two stream schools are actually run side by side. There's no markers in the classroom to indicate whether it's a Mandarin stream or Bahasa stream. You can only go to the class, only headmaster know, because it's The classes are code label, so only the headmaster know whether it's Mandarin stream or English or Bahasa stream. And then the Mandarin stream classes in the school is run by the Bahasa stream classes. And they interact. I mean, they have the same canteen time, they have the same sort of disciplines and so on. Similarly, in SJPC Methodist Anglo-Chinese Sari K, it also had two distinct streams. Here, the headmistress is Mustrik, Rose Wong. She monitors the progress of the two streams every year, very strictly on the board. The performance of the Bahasa stream, the performance of the Chinese stream. And she records it so that the teacher knows. And the teacher, same teachers teach two classes, so the Bahasa stream in the school has got its own ambience, whereas the Mandarin stream also has its own characters. Similarly, in C-Book, SJKC Methodist also have two streams. The two stream classes are actually side by side. One is Zhongwen, one is the M. Yeah? And then this teacher teaches in Mandarin mathematics, this teacher teaches in Bahasa mathematics. But the same teacher will go, you know. So this teacher might go into this class and then switch to Mandarin. This teacher might go to this class and switch into Bahasa. That's how it works. So I find it extremely interesting how it evolves. And if you can go to Sarawak today, there are about 15 of those Chinese schools out of the 100 in the world that operate the dual stream. In the country as a whole, over the past 3 decades, SJKC have gained the recognition of many non-Chinese parents. As Zana Arifin pointed out, the promise of academic rigors and another language had prompted many Malay parents to send their kids there. In 1995, when I was still out there, the Chinese schools had about 10%, 60,000 non-Chinese. 2011 increased to 77,000. Over the last 2 years, the increase in non-Chinese students quite significant. Actually, in 2014, there were 87,000 non-Chinese students out of that improvement of 58,000, about 15%. Now, of course, this has resulted in the adjustment or adaptation of many of the schools, the way they run their classes and so on. Especially out in the rural landscape. I went to Yalas, the Chinese school there, on the first day of school last year, 5th January 2015. I went to the center one class. There were 7 Malays, 3 Chinese, 1 Orangasli, and 1 Indian people reported. They all look very worried, but they are there. I mean, first year, the teachers tried their best to calm them down. And out in the school, the grandparents, the Malay grandparents waiting for their grandkids. They were drinking coffee, waiting for them to finish, to take them back. And so I went and chit-chat with them, asked them how this and stuff. You know, they said, oh, kampung folks. And the school adjusted. The school canteen is actually run by the kampung housewives. They bring the food and then they sell it out to the kids and so on. So that is like the kampung adopting the school, you know. And of course, there were Malay schools nearby. I mean, just the parents choose to send their children to the school. Another interesting example is in Tumpat, Kelantan. The SJPC UC Tumpat was established in 1916, about 100 years ago, earlier Chinese school in Kelantan. At that time, Tumpat was a thriving port. So what they did was, the Chinese community then did was levy a tax on the goods shipped in and out of the port. And that tax was used to help the school. That's how they managed to run the school. Over the years, because the huge demand by the Malay parents to send their kids to the Chinese school, this is a typical example of one of the classes. The school faced, a couple of years ago, faced tremendous classroom shortage. They were short about 10 classes, you know. And so what to do? Fortunately, the school was located next to Sekolah Kebangsaan. The school was located next to SK Kelapuran, Tumpat. And fortunately, the SK school had a new block built. And this is Najib block, this is Mahathir block. That was those days, those days. So the two new blocks. Then mutual respect and understanding. The the scholar Kebangsaan actually rent out or lease out their old block because they have no use for the old block to the Chinese school. And these are Chinese students in the Husin block and the Razak block. The old block, like Husin and Razak, these two block was actually leased out to the Chinese school in the Malay school compound for the Chinese classes. And I think in Negeri Sembilan, in Melaka, out in the rural landscape, similar incidences are happening. In urban areas, the Chinese schools also have increasing non-Chinese enrollments. If you look at this picture, if you take away the red lantern, it's like any other school. You can't tell it's a Chinese school. And in fact, I did deliberate that. I just focused down my camera a bit, zoom in a bit, and this is the same scene. SJKC, Sindhu Pasar, in Kuala Lumpur. Every day you go there, when the school breaks up, this is the same scene. By drivers, right? It's quarantine, I asked. Yeah, it's quarantine. But the SJKC, Sindhu Pasar, has 45% non-Chinese students. And mind you, surrounding the area, there are lots of other schools, but the parents just send them to this. Similarly, in SJKC, Qiaonan, in Stapa, the enrollment of non-Chinese is about 40%. And this is a typical co-curricular activity in the afternoon in the school, where they do the activities together one time. Out in Sabah and Sarawak, the SJKCs have also adapted to their multi-ethnic environment. For example, rubber planting expanded into Papua and before the west coast of Sabah, under the then British, the then was called British Nongbonia in the 1920s. A lot of Chinese smallholders came in from Kudat to settle down in the outlying areas of the west coast. One of the schools that was set up was SJKC Bonghua, which set up in Papua for in 1923 for the incoming smallholders by the Chinese community there. At that time, in the 1950s, the rubber prospered, and the enrollment of school was actually 300-400. But they have since moved up to, because the rubber industry declined, they have since moved out. But the school today remains as a school for the local community. Only 10 of the 77 pupils are Chinese. In this one, they were preparing the school for Mid-Autumn Festival kind of competition. And the lion head they use is a local kind of, it's just a simple structure, what I call a localized lion head. And the kumpang has been used as a substitute for the Chinese drums. This is the way they adjust to the environment. Similarly, in Malabar's Lianhua School in Beaufort, it was set up in 1957. The Chinese just rented a kampung house and started the classes for the rubber smallholder children. They left, but the school has remained as a school for the local Kandasan kids. And fortunately, when they went there, the lease for the kampung house was extended for another 20 years. So by the descendants of the owner. Out of the 20 pupils, 19 are Kandasans today. They enjoy the environment, and the headmaster was very proud because in the year 2014, in the UPSR, they achieved 100% pass rate, so the headmaster was very proud. Similarly, in Sarawak, the timber trade prospered in the early 1950s with the advent of the Korean War. And many Chinese traders then moved up along Rajang River. This school was set up along the Rajang River for the timber workers and the fishermen. But then they have since moved out. But fortunately, the school was located beside the longhouse. And today, it has become the longhouse own school. Oh, they sent all their children there. Today, 46 of the school's 56 pupils are Ibans. Mind you, there are other schools also, but the Ibans want to send them there. I asked them why. Out of curiosity, they said, dia boleh cakap Mandarin lah, Senang Chinese je. That's a simple reply. At the same thing, Mingmok was also set up on the hilltop, on the land donated by Chinese owner. And it was for the incoming workers. Nowadays, it has become the, it served the surrounding longhouses. And of course, why I show this photo is because it has a good view of the Rajang River when they're studying. And of course, with multi-ethnic enrollment comes multicultural activities. When I visited the SDKC Jalan Davidson one afternoon, the students were learning the Malay dance, and actually the school was quite, the headmaster was quite keen. They want the group to win the Malay dance competition, and actually the board actually spent some money to get the two very good Malay dance trainers outside to train them. So that, but I never did ask them whether they won or not, but they spend a lot of effort. And also, many of the parents also demand other activities because they compare the school to international schools. They want their children to have ballroom dancing and so on. So the schools have to respond appropriately, raise some money, and then get a teacher to teach them ballroom dancing. And of course, in Sabah and Sarawak, they also learn they play the native musical instruments. So they get exposure to a variety of things. In a nutshell, a new generation of trilingual Malaysians has emerged from the schools. And this was taken in HKC Pondok Adang in Melaka at the end of the school year. And this was taken in SDKC Chung Hua, Muang.